In this video, we configure outbound network address translation on an Azure subnet so all traffic comes from a specific IP. A topic I caught at Ignite this year was virtual network, network address translation, or NAT. I've ran into a few situations in the past where a vendor had locked access to a resource based on an IP address. Medical and legal research documentation websites come to mind, but I'm sure there are many other examples. And what about MFA trusted IPs? These are public IP addresses listed as trusted sites and excluded from conditional access policies. You may want to extend that feature to your Windows Virtual Desktop environment so your Windows Virtual Desktop users don't have to use MFA to access Office 365 resources. In both cases, having known static IP addresses for the client in Azure would be beneficial. You can assign static public IP addresses to a VM in Azure, but they cost money and would be difficult to manage for large environments. This is especially true for Windows Virtual Desktop. The session host may share the same public IP, but there's no native way to control that or set a specific IP. Before we go any further, please take a second to like, subscribe, and share, and click the bell icon to get notifications of new content or when I go live. In this video, we go over using a NAT gateway on a VNet. An Azure NAT gateway provides a static IP address or IP address ranges for internet traffic from one or more subnets. This is much like how users access the internet on premises. All users' internet activity is NATed behind a public IP address, typically on a firewall. Let's start with how VMs in Azure behave by default. When a computer on a VNet without a public IP address or not behind a load balancer connects to the internet, it's NATed behind an Azure public IP. This is not configurable. There's no way to guarantee that IP will be the same if the VM's redeployed or even restarted. If a computer is behind a load balancer or has a public IP address assigned to the NIC, that public IP is used for all inbound traffic. With a NAT gateway, all outbound traffic comes from the gateway's static IPs or IP address ranges. It doesn't interfere with inbound connections going to the load balancer or public IP address assigned to the Azure resource. There are some things to know about NAT gateways. It won't allow inbound connections. There's other Azure resources for that. Multiple subnets in a VNet can use the same NAT gateway. A NAT gateway can have up to 16 public IP addresses or public IP prefixes or a mix of both. The TCP timeout can be configured between 4 and 120 minutes. There's an option to use availability zones. NAT is regional by default. Although multiple subnets can use a NAT gateway cannot span multiple VNets. A NAT gateway won't support a subnet if that subnet has public IPs or load balancers with a basic SKU attached to it. And there's no support for IPv6. Before we get started with the lab, here's an overview of what we're going to do. I have a subnet with some Windows Virtual Desktop session hosts installed on it. I want to exclude those Windows Virtual Desktop session hosts from MFA by adding the public IP address to the trusted MFA site list. To learn more about MFA enforcement when connecting to Windows Virtual Desktop, see my previous video on the subject. I'm going to enable the NAT gateway on my VNet and subnet, and then add the public IP address to the MFA trusted IP list. Once added, users should not get prompted for MFA when they're logging into the O365 portal or any other O365 resource. Let's get started in the portal. Here I am logged into a session host with Windows Virtual Desktop. Let's take a look at the public IP address with IP Chicken. It's showing the IP address of 40.69.157.45. Next, let's go to portal.office.com. And I'll sign in as a user on this tenant. And notice it's giving me an MFA prompt. I'm going to stop here. I don't need to actually sign in. I just needed to see that prompt. Next, let's go to the Azure portal. Let's get started with adding a NAT gateway to the subnet. I'm using Windows Virtual Desktop session host for this example, but it would work the same with any other server on the subnet. Let's go to create a resource and find NAT gateway. click on NAT Gateway, and create. Make sure your subscription's correct, and then I'm going to go to the resource groups. I like to put all my network-based resources into a network resource group, so I'll add that. You could create a new one, too, if you wanted. I'm going to give it a name. I'll call it WVD NAT GW. Select the region where your VNet is located. Your VNet and your gateway have to be in the same region. In my case, it's Central US. I don't need availability zones, but you can select zone 1, 2, or 3. And for this example, I'll leave the idle timeout to 4 minutes. We'll go next to outbound IP address. And I'm going to create a new one. I'll call this WVD pub IP. And notice that the SKU and the assignment are not changeable. It has to be a standard SKU, and the assignment has to be static. So I'll click OK. And next, although I'm not going to create one, there is an option to create a new public IP prefix. So you can add a whole block of IP addresses if you'd like. And you can do that in addition to public IP addresses. I'll click Cancel and move on to Subnet. Here we're going to select our virtual network. I only have one in the subscription, and I only have one subnet. But if you did have multiple, you could select multiple, or you could select all of them. But in this case, I have a simple setup with only one subnet. Next, I'll go to Tags, Add Tags as needed, and then we'll go to Review and Create. And we'll create. The deployment finished, and here I am in the resource group. I have the virtual network object that was there before, but I've got two new objects. I've got the WVD NAT GW for the NAT gateway, and I've also got a public IP address. So let's go into the NAT gateway. From here, we can go to subnets under settings to see what subnets it's attached to. And that was what we selected on deployment. You can go into configuration. Here we can set the idle timeout if we want to change it from 4 minutes. We've got properties. We can take a look at that. Let's go to outbound IP addresses. Here it shows the public IP address and what that IP address is. So it's 52.141.223.64. You can add additional public IP addresses if you need to. Or you can add entire IP address prefixes if you need to. Now that that's set, I'm going to copy this IP address. Let's add that to the MFA Trusted Site list. We do that by going to Azure Active Directory. We'll go to Security, Name Locations, and from there we have this option of pop-out for Configure MFA Trusted Sites. And here I'll add the IP address. If you have more than one IP address, you can add it here. Add a slash 32 to indicate one specific IP address. Or if you have a range, you can add an entire range in at this point. Once done, I'll click Save. I already have the rules set up to enforce MFA for all users. And that also has the trusted IP list added as an excluded location. So now that I updated that list, I should be able to go to portal.office.com from my Windows Virtual Desktop client in Azure without requiring MFA. Let's go give that a try. I'll go back to Chrome. And first, let's go to IP Chicken again. Okay, here it shows my updated IP address. So that is correct. That's the new external IP address. Next, I'll go to portal.office.com. Sign in as the same user. I'll select No at the Stay Signed In page. And that worked. It let me go in without an MFA prompt. That worked as expected. We added a static NAT gateway to the subnet and then added that IP address to the MFA trusted IP list. Now users accessing 0365 from within my Windows Virtual Desktop environment are not required to use MFA. I hope you found this helpful. Keep in mind, this example may have been for Windows Virtual Desktop, but there are other use cases as well. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.